you want to have fun.
No, like all of them in the group could debate at the end, but that guy in the middle was always after someone says he picks up some of the lines of what he has said and then starts pulling the pants. Like, why did you say?
Yeah,
what
we can do that.
In fact.
Yeah, all right, fine. So after the opening statements, I might, if I feel like, intervene and ask some cross questions, but very brief, just maybe one or two, so that the flow of the, at least the opening statements is not disrupted. And then during cross questioning, maybe we can ask more questions. Okay? All right. So let's start. The team for the motion, you can start with the opening statement. It's a 2 to 3 minute opening statement. So at 3 minutes, I will just mute you. Okay, start.
So online education is an effective mode of education with the amount of versatility it offers in the factors that there are no longer any physical infrastructural boundaries and geographical proximities. It has this mode of education has grown increasingly popular during the lockdown.
Yes. Hello, Ishan. Yes. Just go a little slower because you're reading very fast. Nobody will be able to follow. Go ahead. Don't stop.
Yeah. So online education is an effective mode of education because it offers a number of versatile options. Then the major benefit of the online educational system is that there is no longer a geographical physical barrier of infrastructure and access. So this mode of education has grown popular during the COVID-19 lockdown, but even after the lockdown ends and even after the virus like people get vaccinated over the virus, this mode of education should continue because of the various inherent benefits it offers. Such that students from different geographical areas can attend classes from different countries as well, and the same applies for the quality of education as teachers and faculties from different regions can also also conduct the school. And I think I'm done. Does anyone want to add?
Okay, that.
Actually, we were
not like less than a minute. 3 minutes.
We actually thought that as an opening statement, so we just thought it was like one statement to sort of start the motion, start the argument.
Okay. Because I had said it's a 2 to 3 minute opening statement, huh? Something like 800 words or something. Okay, fine. So the question is, Ishan, then what about people who you think everybody can access online education from all different geographical areas?
So like there's obviously the issue of the penetration of internet access. Like in India, there's only a 50% penetration access, but if looked at it from the start, like the internet infrastructure is growing, and this is just like the start. Like this is the first time that we are ever doing a sort of online mode of education. So if this mode of education can prove that it's a viable method, then the internet penetration will definitely grow. So the amount of access will keep on increasing.
So you know, we did a survey with the student body in KRVI in the beginning of the lockdown, and we found about 25% students have issues not just internet related but even device related. And this is Kamala Raheja, which is a fairly better off school where most students are from metropolitan cities. So you can imagine the other schools and the kinds of problems that they are having, students from within these other schools. So how do you think it's going to make education accessible to everybody?
So that question can be answered from the lens of looking at cloud computing. So for example, if you look at our mobile phones, whenever we use Google Maps, it's not actually our phones that are doing all the calculations and all the the algorithms. And all. It actually happens in the servers, and we basically only need an internet connection. So if like I said earlier, if the online method does prove to be at least viable, then these cloud computing softwares can be developed further and further to sort of make it such that people will no longer need to have a strong machine And they will just need to have a just have an internet access to access various softwares also.
Yeah, but what about people who don't even have, let's say, electricity? Because you are, you know, in Bombay, you don't have an issue of power cuts, but in most other cities, you have at least 3 or 4 hour power cuts every day. People who don't have laptops, maybe don't have a cell phone plan with data in it. What about that? Okay, anyway, so let's hear the opening statement from the against team.
Yeah, sure. What is online education? Online education is electronically supported learning that relies on the internet for teacher or student interaction and the distribution of class material. Over the past 2 decades, online education has grown considerably and shifted from margins to become the main mode of education. Online education is not a new development for many top-tier colleges and universities, but the current crisis has forced nearly every institution increasing its reliance on online instruction, becoming the primary medium of imparting knowledge. Despite the rapid development of online education, it creates barrier that educator and student counter that affect an overall quality of learning. Online education can open doors that were once closed for many working or place-bound individuals who aspire, but may lack the opportunity to attend college. But the broad access to poorly designed online courses will exaggerate already existing gaps in educational achievement. There are a number of technologies available for online education, but sometimes they create a lot of difficulties. The barrier that online education create are not only limited to technological difficulties, but also with respect to communication barrier, mental health issues, cyberbullying, less practical knowledge, social isolation, and decrease in cross-learning. This is from our side.
Okay, so Nachiketa, all the problems that you're listing out for the online education can be our problems even in offline education. You think bullying doesn't happen in school. You think that courses are not poorly designed when they're offline. You think that there are no communication barriers when people are in face-to-face classes. All of these exist. So what is so special about online education?
I agree that bullying does happen in the schools also when there is a post structure, but when it comes to online cyberbullying, you can see the case from our class only, like Madhura has been, it's a kind of cyberbullying, right? And for the social structure and cross learning, from my perspective, I say it like it's very difficult, it's getting very difficult for me to cross learn. When we are in college, I can go around the studio and see what the other guys are doing, but when it comes to online, I see those only particular things, but I don't understand what they're doing, because I was not there when they were explaining or something like that. There's also okay. parts
but
like
isn't it easier to access things which you are not where you are not present? So in online education, you can record and then you can watch it later, which you can't do when there's face-to-face interaction, isn't it?
That is one plus point for online education, but
okay, so let's go to the other person for opening yep. statement.
Right. So online education was has been going on before the COVID times, and I feel that we cannot really particularly look at how the pandemic has affected the education system, rather than we should just look at because that sort of skews the study. Rather, we should look at if online education as a system is good enough in isolation.
Tana, are you arguing for or against?
For. I'm arguing for. So I'm saying that online. So, okay. So I'm so sorry. There have been studies which have been taken place before the pandemic sort of hit. And In those studies, it has been stated that a lot of students prefer online education and their productivity increases with an online sort of structured course. So,
who did this study?
The study was taken in 2008 by a person named Lundberg.
And what software products is he selling that he was interested in creating data that justifies his product in the market?
Right. So a questionnaire was sort of sent to students of a university, and he concluded that the students would prefer to take online courses.
Which university was this?
We'll put the links in the chat.
Yeah, we'll include the links.
That's not the point. And in any case, let's say this was done in Sweden. Okay. Would there be identical results if they were that survey was done in India? Okay, no response. All right. Against team.
Can I respond to that?
No, not now. And then maybe in the cross questioning stage, you can come in, Ishan. All right, we heard the second opening statement.
Yes. So education is not just about subject knowledge, but also about developing social skills and practical knowledge among the students, which is built over years. Relying solely on online education may hinder the holistic development of children, and many may underperform later in their professional and personal life. Learning alone in front of screens may lead to reduction of interest in the subject, and a physical and interactive environment make the learning environment more enjoyable. Hence the proverb, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. Using the internet for entertainment is common, but for online lessons, it is a big challenge. Body language and eye contact, which are important cues for the teacher, are difficult to perceive in online classes. Science and technology programs often include hands-on laboratory sessions, dissertation projects, and field trips to complement theoretical studies. And architecture and engineering streams have site visits as an integral part of the education. Similarly, it applies for medical students. This aspect of learning is severely limited in online education. Every generation of students from KG, school, college to PhD students, each of them face their own set of issues, and with them, so does the corresponding faculty. Humans are social beings, and the online mode increases the isolation and anxiety. Education is not just about dumping information and retaining it, whereas in a physical format, we also develop the skill of collaborative working. The online mode restricts the scope of group discussions and brainstorming sessions, which in turn impacts the productivity. After all, deliberation, reasoning, and analysis, which all these three things are best achieved with interaction with peers. This is something that does not come easily with digital education. Thank you.
Okay, Ishan, I think, the thing is, you say that there is the quality of education is better if you do it offline, and that this is possible and that is not possible. But of course, collaboration is possible even on an online platform. And also, you don't provide any evidence to support the idea that there is that some one is better than the other. It's a statement, but it's more like a plea. It's not an argument at all. You know, what is on what basis are you saying that quality of education is better when it is provided offline? In fact, you can argue that since more people, a diversity of people are involved in online education, the quality will improve through online collaborative formats rather than offline where only one kind of people are meeting every day. So I don't understand on what basis you arrive at the conclusion that this is better than the other.
When it's online, it's a static environment, whereas when it's physical.
What is static environment? What is so dynamic about an offline environment?
The thing is that the interaction is more easier to happen in a offline environment.
I don't think so. Anyway, let's move on to the next stage, cross questions. So what we'll do is we'll have the team against the motion, first questioning the team for the motion, and then vice versa. We'll have maybe one or two rounds of this before we open it up to audience questions. All right. So the against team, you want to first pose the question? That's Ishan, Inandar, and Sana. Or maybe you can also have other people from the team asking questions. Yeah, that's fine.
Does the four have to question or the against have to question?
No, the against will question the four first.
I had one question. When we say ki in the online form of education, you have recordings and you can archive everything and then that can be viewed later on. So matlab, that means eventually we are going towards a future where we imagine everything happening on a screen and the actual interaction, matlab, how do we see education? It's just like I say, information coming to us one way, or is it like both ways and it's a more interactive form of thing? So is this a future where the screen takes over most of our social life and also educational in that sense desirable? So that was the question.
So yeah, the four team, you want to go respond to that?
One aspect of this is that because this is during the lockdown time, the increased exposure to screen is not only because of the completely online school, but it's also because we're also trapped in our house. Suppose that we assume that the pandemic is over and everything is normal and you still go for online school, then you would not be in your room the entire time cooped up. Maybe you could sit in India and you could maybe do course in some other country if you wanted to. So over there, maybe half the day you would spend on your laptop, but then the other half of the day you would be free to go out. Maybe you could partake in your other hobbies. So thinking that your entire life will sort of revolve around the computer because you are in that school would not hold true post the lockdown period.
But the half the day wala thing that you were saying, which is not happening in our case, like we are not getting even half of the day. We aren't getting any time after the study period gets over for the hobbies and stuff in this type of system.
I think this is very specific to our situation and our college. And in fact, it actually directly relates to something we were talking to the faculty about before this debate started. But if we look at the larger picture of the debate, which is the quality of education, I don't think this should be, if like a course is structured, which all courses are on, whether it be online or offline, this issue should not be a problem. Like the clear demarcation in time is a very personal issue, which depends on the set of faculties, which differs from college to college or school to school. So it's not a general issue. It sounds more like a personal issue which a set of students might be facing.
Yeah,
this personal issue is faced by a lot of students, not just a group of students.
and a whole chunk of them.
A whole chunk of people also spend hours traveling back and forth to college. What about all of that time saved? A huge, like 2 hours in Mumbai traffic, one way.
Yeah, so the question, so I think it is supposed to be a response to the question. So the question was related to screens, right? So what Bansi said and what Diya said, I don't think it relates much with screen. But what Ishan said, I would like to add to that, ki even if you have like half a day on screen, a half day you can do whatever you want. The half day on screen, I think there is a big ignorance ki the amount of physical space even a screen would need. Matlab, a part of your house has to be secluded and you need the privacy to be in the mental state in front of the screen as well. So, matlab, is that even possible to do like a 9-to-3 thing for a part of your house to be secluded from the entire other part? Because when you when you are at home, you are playing a different role. As matlab, you play the role of a student in front of the screen, but also you have your own role playing in the family. So how that also creates a problem when there's a screen.
Bansi, you have your hand raised. Come in.
Yeah, so to answer one part of it, as you said that you spend half the day and it might become a little overwhelming to be in front of a screen. So going back to one of the points which we had mentioned earlier, that how the online mode of education actually gives you the flexibility to view some part of the content which is being taught at a later part during the day. And it unlike when you're in college, if due to some medical reasons or some personal issues, if you have to leave the college, you entirely miss it. But here, actually, you have the convenience and facility to watch some missed out bits and parts when you want it and overall not miss out and not fall back compared to your peers.
Adding on to the sort of mental preparation, I feel that that mental preparation can take place even in a physical sort of environment if a person has anxiety issues. It really depends on that. And in fact, at home, I feel if a person has to have to access education online via their houses, they have that sort of ability to maybe if they feel that they want to sort of remain a little excluded, they have that sort of option. But you won't have that option in a physical college or school system.
Nishanti, your hand is raised. Go ahead. Last comment before we take the second question. All right.
Yeah, I'm part of the FOR team. And I just want to say that we are arguing for online education, not online to be a part of your lifestyle. Our course is such that it involves a lot of time in front of the screen, but most courses don't involve this much engagement. Also to talk about the physical space that you require in your home, schools and colleges and physical infrastructure that offline schools require also require tremendous amount of resources and space, and the elimination of that and you know it kind of gets dispersed into smaller spaces is a much less it takes a lot less resources.
Okay, so now let's have the FOR team asking the question to the against team.
Yes. While you said that the ability and the access in a physical school is sort of like the online school sort of, just give me a second. So like the point was mentioned that a lot of people don't have internet and like they don't have spaces at their home to sort of go and experience the quote unquote better life in college. I think one important point that you're missing is that there's a lot of people who have certain disabilities or have certain disabilities who at some point have no choice but to sort of take a drop or something. Like I have heard stories in our college where students have gotten malaria and they have to sort of drop out or they have to stay at home, they have to work from the hospital. People with motor disabilities, if they're not able to access the college space, then they are straight up sort of excluded from the space. But over here, if something like that happens, then the person can easily continue from the comfort of their home. And adding up to it, in a lot of places, if a person stays far away, or even taking the example of a college which does not either have a lift or a ramp, a person with a motor disability would not be able to participate in our course. But because of online college, they are able to participate. So, how would you sort of address this point about the access of the physical space also not being as of a whole thing as the online space? Like the physical space also have their exclusions.
Okay, so physical space also has exclusions. Against him, you want to respond to that question?
Yeah, that's the question.
Go ahead.
They will respond now, right?
Yeah, yeah. The against team has to respond.
Yeah.
No response? Seriously, there are 20 people in the team. No one has an answer to that question. Okay, that's interesting. All right, so fine. So now let's have audience questions, teams that are not participating. Anybody wants to ask questions to either of the teams or both of the teams, if you like. Just unmute yourself and ask. No need to raise hands and all that, I think.
Statistically, it has been proven that interactive learning with where you actually for practical work or for any kind of work, like where you actually are there at the site, you learn through watching and listening. It has proven to be much better than just reading and listening. So how would you guys respond to that?
This question is for both teams?
No, for the 14.
For the 14, okay.
So although there are advantages of the physical medium that the teacher can stand in front of you and make you explain things, the benefit of the online medium is that the student can at any point revisit the recorded lectures and have access to it whenever they want. So there's a lot, like you might forget what happened in the physical space, but even if you were in the class and you know what happened in the digital environment, you can always revisit the space very easily, which is not something you can do at a hands, like an instance in the physical space.
Also, there can be like a versatility of learning methods itself. Offline, there's like one medium of instruction, but here, depending on what kind of learner a person is, you can have those different sources of absorbing information.
Yeah. Lalit, you can go ahead. Don't raise your hand. Just unmute and start talking.
Yeah, to the point of Ishan saying that having lectures recorded and having the privilege to watch it again if you have missed it in the physical world. So is it that we are making ourselves our memories weak, like thinking that we have something, we have the privilege to watch it later. So it's making ourselves less focus on the present issue, the present we are in. Instead of focusing on the lecture, it generally happens. Personally also feels that we generally lose focus thinking that we can watch this recording later also. So
I think what you're talking about, as you yourself stated, this is something very personal, and it sounds again more like sounds an issue with the perception of this of some specific students, rather than it being a fault of the medium of the education. And when we say online education, we do not intend for it just to be a lecture series. Like we have seen our faculties ourselves trying really hard to make lectures and make conversation with us. So it depends on the mindset of a student, and a student who doesn't want to learn or who doesn't want to pay attention. It doesn't matter. Like in real life also, many of us do zone out during normal lecture sitting in a studio as well. So it really depends on the approach of the student, which is a personal choice a student makes, and it cannot be put as a disadvantage of the medium of education.
And adding on to that, I think that, in fact, as Bansi mentioned, that in a physical space also one tends to lose focus. But the online education sort of becomes a little more efficient because the recordings are sort of backing up. So you know that if you miss something, you can always go back to it. It's not about making someone complacent. It's about giving them a second chance. To learn something.
And there are many people who do suffer from issues like ADHD. So, and it is often in many students, it goes undetected for their whole lives. So if you look at those, it's very helpful for people with such disabilities as well, in which this sort of education will ensure that they can, they're not segregated off or something, but they can continue learning with the whole class. Because the recordings are available.
Yeah. So the point that losing focus even in the offline medium is that in a classroom, if there's a teacher or a guard, like a teacher or a professor who tends to refocus a student who gets distracted, and related to a classroom structure, it's always the distractions are always relating to like with friends or other students, and in comparatively when you are at online education at home, there are tons of other distractions, namely the it could be internet, the phone, pets, siblings, it could be anything like the kitchen. There are tons of other distractions in at home comparatively and in a classroom. And so in offline medium, there's always someone who will try to get you to refocus on the subject.
The overall question, I think, has to come back to the age group that we're talking about. So if we're talking about adult sort of age group, I think it's fine. Like you can say that a student is sort of responsible for whether he studies or not, but for a younger age group like children, they are sort of being held by the parents who are supposed to tell them to study. But when there is no teacher around, what is there to incentivize them or like tell them that they are supposed to study right now and focus on the task at hand right now?
Yeah, adding on to Mehta, for children, it is the age for playing on playgrounds or going to the library, sitting in the library, not sitting in front of the screen or reading the book on the screen and, you know, straining their eyes and that.
Oh, adding on to the same point, how do you justify developing fine motor skills for children in an online medium?
Paul, team, you have a response to that?
I think a lot of points were mentioned. I think everyone from the group can take up one. Something like, straining their eyes on the screen. So in fact, if it's on a laptop screen, you can practically zoom it in as much as.
Yeah, but sitting for long hours on the screen, same screen and zooming in, what is the use?
Sana was interrupted, now there are 4 points to answer, so we'll just take 20-30 seconds to regroup, so we'll just decide who's addressing what point. Yeah.
Okay, we'll just go over the points one by one. So, addressing the question about like for younger children who won't develop motor skills. I think we mentioned before, it's not only the online media, like we need to think from the online medium from the point of a from the point of a world that has even moved past the lockdown. So, I've seen the preschool, how the preschool goes, I have a small niece, and the way even now that it's happening in COVID time is that they do have online schools in the morning for an hour or two, but after that they do have small physical group sessions, and sometimes they are in the school, sometimes they are in local parks around them, or sometimes it sort of happens with the parents only with them. So the parents sort of spend time with them and they only themselves teach.
Yeah. Also addressing the issue of attention span and losing focus, online courses are obviously structured according to their respective age groups, and so I don't think that should be an issue. And also talking about if someone has to in fact tell you to start gaining focus, I think that makes a student more complacent. But in an online sort of system, you yourself will have to be responsible for yourself and answerable to yourself. So that sort of brings about a little more integrity as a student ethic.
Four arguments.
Can
we complete our answering?
We had to ask.
Two people have already spoken.
Just let them finish.
Yeah,
let them finish the.
Yeah, we'll say we have
the four.
Yeah, another thing that I didn't really get the merit in is Lalit mentioned that, we have the option of viewing a recording, so we're kind of weakening our memory, quote unquote. So do you think education is about retaining more information? Is that all there is to education? It's almost like saying, why have books, you should have just heard it the first time, like you're weakening your memory.
Yeah, so again, the point is, the debate is actually on, we're debating on the topic of quality of education in an online medium in any circumstances and not about memory, I guess. And also that we need to focus on the online medium in every circumstance, not just on the COVID and in the COVID situation.
Exactly, we're talking of the education system, if it's viable in its own. So we're not talking of the different approaches taken by different student groups or faculty groups. So talking about that, loss of focus does not become that valid of a point.
Okay, does anybody want to respond to this?
Yeah. So speaking about the structuring of the courses, like many of the schools, if you talk with the children, they don't have a proper structure for online education. They have not even started their new terms when other schools are already halfway, already have completed one of the terms. So you really in India, in many of the places for online education, we don't have an answer for how to make it. We have not made a proper structure till now, many of them, not all, many of the schools have not made them. Many of them don't have the hardware to do it. Many of them don't have the availability. Many of them can't afford it. Many of them, many of the places, this system has only not reached. So as a way, if you're telling it improves the quality of education, it may be improving, but if it does not reach everywhere, and I don't think it will reach ahead also, if ever it reaches there, you will have to first teach them. You will have to first make the adults over there learn what it is, and then they will then teach the children. They don't have a simple smartphone and you are telling that they will handle a laptop or whatever. The provision has not yet reached, and we are talking about making a structure for the courses. Like you will find children idling their time away in their gullies, in the grounds, the whole day. If you ask them school, they don't have a school for a year or so. So the government schools are totally going totally vacant. Like you aren't doing anything over there. if you move on to the villages, if you see over there, it is the adults who are taking the initiative to cancel out this, like they are not taking the online education, but they are going on bicycles from place to place and giving physical education so that their whole year does not go away. So if you are telling that, so if COVID is not there and you are telling that online education could be an important means, but I don't think it is for now. It is as a means it is available in India, especially except for these metropolitan cities. You can't get such provisions in, except for the metropolitan, you can't get such provisions at all the places. It's a huge extent you are covering through online education.
Nishanti, your hand was raised. You can go
ahead. To what Keyur mentioned, a lot of things. First of all, I would like to ask for a source for the claim that there simply aren't any structures.
So for the source, father visits such small, like near in and around Dahanu, they have this a belt, not sort of a connection with many of the schools over there.
Keyur, could I respond to all of your points first, and then maybe you can talk about everything.
Sorry.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Sorry. So, firstly, the thing is that the online system was not as widespread before the pandemic. And because the pandemic has started, it has been forced to be implemented in a very short amount of time, because the lockdowns were only announced. And then within weeks, everything had to shift to an online medium. Even now, people are anticipating that the lockdowns will end and people can go back to their schools and colleges. So they are still not investing in the infrastructure. So like you said about the devices and things like that, nobody's really investing in it right now because they don't see it as a long-term permanent solution. So that's not really fair to say that, because they have invested in actual buildings. And so, I mean, also it's a lot more expensive to pay the bills for like the fans and the lights and all of the infrastructure that comes with a physical college and a physical school and space. They have not been able to give that kind of, because they don't want to, right? It's not a permanent solution at all. So our experience, this class's experience of online school, is not an actual thing, because we kind of hate it. I mean, all of us hate it, even on our group, because we hate the lockdown, we hate COVID, we hate not being able to interact with people. But it's not so that was the first thing that I wanted to address, that it is the infrastructure is not there because nobody's investing in it, because they're expecting to go back to school, and because it had to happen very, very abruptly, people are still kind of adjusting to it. This is a system that has developed for centuries, and then suddenly we have had to very quickly implement something new. Secondly, you spoke about how it's not possible for India. So the thing is, a large part of India, which is rural India, the main problem of education is that they don't have the physical infrastructure. Like, you have to build the schools, but then you also have to have teachers who are willing to come there, you know, the ability to pay the teachers to come there, the students who have to travel really, really large distances. Now, I'm not saying that right now everybody has access to internet and everybody has devices to access online education, but online school as a solution to that, providing the internet access, providing electricity and things like that, is a lot more easy to do than to actually make the schools pay the teachers enough to travel kilometers and kilometers to come to school, make sure that the children have school buses to come and take them. All of that allied infrastructure is very difficult to provide, and online school is something that could really, really benefit India, especially rural India. Obviously, it'll take effort, but it'll take a lot less effort.
Wait, it is not easy to set up a computer lab. Like you in a rural like in a school over there, you don't have a proper infrastructure, because you don't have someone to invest in. But at the same time, matlab proper seedha saada infrastructure hi lane ko itna ye ho raha hai, to hum log kaise udhar computer lab ya fir they don't have the electricity, the electricity has not reached those places, and we are telling that the online education is a thing that could improve their first, you know, it is like a real long way to go over there. So it is better to make the current situation that they have, like you are telling that teachers availability nahi hai. Yeah, teachers availability nahi hai kyunki wo gaon mein
जब यो टीचर आएगा तो उसके फैमिली के साथ उनको उधर बैठने के लिए जगह चाहिए, लाइक दे ऑल्सो नीड द फैसिलिटीज, राइट? एवरीबडी हैज दैट. सो you need to improve first there, and then you have to talk about like online education improving the online education improving the quality of the system.
So people have been trying to resolve this issue with offline infrastructure for a very long time.
It has still not been there, but people are trying to improve, but it has still not been there. Then talking about online education, that will never be there again. Because the normal, the basic infrastructure is also not, and then we talk about online education at a, you know, something that is very far-fetched.
Okay, so Sarth has raised his hand. Sarth, you want to go ahead?
So how do we address the question of language barrier in a context like India, where you have such a varied languages, and how is online education accessible to those people? I mean, I don't think there is a online education happening in their respective languages. Also, someone mentioning the point that allowing students to be long hours on screen and then taking them to their park is like ruining their active life, and then putting a band-aid on top of it. So How do you guys answer that thing?
Okay, so we'll do one thing. After you respond to these questions by Sarth, we'll stop the debate. So maybe one round of responses, maybe a response by the for team, and then a counter by the against team, and then we'll stop. All right? Go ahead.
Actually, we didn't understand the point properly. Could you just repeat it again?
Sarth, you can repeat. You can repeat the question, Sarth.
Yeah, I'm saying that. So someone from you guys mentioned that allowing them on long hours, when we argued about that screen times increases a lot, and that that ruins their active life. So there was a counter to it, that they can just go to a park after that. So it's like creating a problem and then giving a solution for it. So I mean, I didn't understand the validity of that counter thing. Secondly, I asked about the language barrier. In India, we have such a variety of languages, which I'm very sure in those dialects we don't have online education, and this how is this online education accessible then? How has it improved the quality of education for these people? Also the point that Nishanti mentioned, where she says that providing infrastructure for online thing will happen in a short period of time, or maybe in the longer run, or people are not interested to invest in it right now because that does not seem a solution for the long run, then it's being conditional, right? How, like, agar aisa hua to, and also about the structure as well. If the course is structured well, then online can be a good, but currently it is being not. So how does it improve the quality of education?
Okay, so I'll just I'll first address the language barrier part of it. There are actually a lot of courses which take place in a lot of languages. It's not that there is just one language offered for a course. Secondly, what usually happens in an online sort of schooling system, a lot of transcripts are automated, and there are also options to keep subtitles for the people itself. So that in fact would not happen in an offline sort of system. So and also you can simultaneously have a translating app
for example, to understand that, to get over those language barriers. So there are a lot of options, and I don't think it also, it's not that in an offline medium, the language barrier would go, right? It still exists. So, yeah.
So maybe one more counter. Last person, counter. Manthi, your voice is breaking. Just one second. Just hold on and start again.
Can I answer Sat till then?
Go ahead.
So the point where you mentioned that it's counterproductive to say that online karke fir baad mein park mein jayenge, that's I think assuming that people who do have to that's assuming that offline spaces do provide that need of the social and the social and the recreational need. Like for a lot of people, not only traveling is an issue, but like not only the traveling time is an issue, but going to the place and coming back to the place, you can't really, like, there's a lot of places you can't really say ki, like assuming that you'll have some sort of vacation is not really a statement. On the other hand, if it's online, you can attend your classes and then you can go and have your if you want to go to the gym or if you go to the park, then you can schedule a time accordingly. Whereas on online, you have to depend on the, like, if you live far away, then you have to depend on traffics and time schedules of the trains and buses and stuff like that.
Okay, Prasad, your hand is raised. We'll take the last comment from you and then we'll stop. All right.
Yeah, I was saying that Ishan still didn't answer the question it's the screen timing and all those like online activities that which those activities have been affecting that person. So how do you go about that, Mulab? Like, I didn't get the counterpoint from Ishan.
Also, to Prasad, when you mentioned that students living far away, then even this becomes a personal opinion. I mean, not everyone lives far away from their schools, right? So,
it's less of a personal thing, it's more of a physical
Bansi, your voice is still breaking. Bansi, you want to start again? We didn't hear. At least I couldn't hear. Okay, so we have lost Bansi. All right.
Can
okay.
Hear me?
Yeah, now it's better. Bol.
Yeah, so what Sark said.
Okay, one second. So is Bansi in the four team or the against team?
She's in the four team. She's
in the four team, yes.
Yeah, she's in the four team, okay.
I would like to address this team time concern. Can I go?
Yeah, okay. Chalo, last comment. Then we'll stop, huh? Because otherwise we'll go on all day.
I just want to say that we cannot blame our screen time purely on online education, because our screen times were still extremely ridiculous before COVID started. I mean, social media, Netflix, you name it. But like, we cannot put the entire stress of screen time on online education.
Okay. I think two people have their hands raised, but I think we should stop now because three people have their hands raised. But we'll stop now. Okay. And you guys can probably take this conversation forward. All right. So now what we need to do is that the audience, the remaining 40 who are not participating in this debate, have to vote for the winning team. Now, remember when you cast your vote that you have to not think about what you like, whether you're for the motion or against the motion, but you have to judge whether what do you think about the debaters, right? And who made better arguments for or against. Okay. And based on that, you cast your vote. What the way you can do that, maybe the CRs can organize this. If you have a simple Excel sheet of the 40 people who are not participating, and in front of their column, if they can say for or against which team they're voting for. So we'll get a response list. And once it's completed, you can share it with us. Okay. So just do that after class whenever in the next week or so. All right.
Yeah,
so
we can circulate a Google form instead.
Yeah, just to circulate a Google form. Yeah. Okay, so now the next debate is not next week. Okay, it's the following week. So you have about 14 days to prepare for the next debate. Okay, but there are a few things that I'd like to say that maybe the next debate people can try to address. One is that if you you know, a large part of this debate was about sharing experiences, which is fine, but it ought to be complemented with a little bit of research on this question. So I mean, in the reservations bit, it will be more difficult to talk through experience. You will have to do a little bit of secondary research. So please do that. And in case you need references for that, please ask us. We'll help you. We'll provide them to you. Okay. But let the debate be a little more informed by, you know, by the existing literature on the subject. For this debate, it was fine. But for the next debate, that will not work. Okay. Just a few things that you should keep in mind when you are participating in a debate. Now, one thing that seems to have been missing entirely in the debate, I'm just pointing out things that were missing, which were glaring omissions. One is that from the perspective of the team who are arguing against the motion, actually, you know, one thing that the for team did, which you probably did not anticipate, is that they spoke about the exclusions in the offline space. Okay, now, the exclusions in the online space are much greater than the offline space. Okay, so it would have been really easy to rebut that point. Often you debate, when you're debating, you don't only come with your prepared arguments, but you also tactically respond based on the line that your opposing team is taking. So in a debate, the response is very important, both to be factually and analytically sharp, but at the same time also rhetorically effective. So debate, the debate format is also to a large extent about the performance of the debate, right? So how effectively you make the argument. So it is a mix of rhetoric and information. It's not only information, and it's not only rhetoric. If you do either of them, your case gets weakened, you know. I mean, I can come with a lot of facts. So that can be a tactic, you know. You can overwhelm the opposing team with factual information, which they cannot process quickly enough to be able to respond. That's one tactic. But you, when you do a debate, you should have a strategy. The strategy should be, okay, you should try to, you know, it's like a game of chess. You should try to anticipate what the other team is going to come up with and prepare in advance for those kinds of lines of argument. And in this debate, it was fairly easy to anticipate what both the teams are going to say. Okay, there would be a question of screen time, and there would be a question of exclusion, and there would be a question of access, and all of those you should have, you know, anticipated and have had ready responses to. Then there would be other things which you don't anticipate. That is okay, then you can improvise. But at least the standard lines of argument you should be able to easily dismiss. Okay. And you can decide how you want to dismiss it, either through an anecdote or through data or whichever means. But be prepared, try to anticipate the opposing team's points well in advance. Okay, so that is of crucial importance. Also, structure your argument. what happens is when you structure your arguments, the audience can receive the information. You know, a large part of education, if you notice through your lifetimes, if you notice the teachers who have been very effective in what they have taught you, they have been effective because they have structured the inputs that they're giving you in a manner that is easy to retain as well as immediately relates to you. Okay, so these two things are very important: structuring the information and relating to people's experiences. Okay, and if you do those two things immediately, you will resonate with your audience. There will be, you know, there will be people who will have a lot of information but who can't deliver it in a structured way, and then what happens is people don't follow what is being said. So break your information. In the debate that we sent you, you would see that there was this one team who are arguing against the motion. They had very structured rebuttal. You know, they were not just talking, they were structuring their responses in a very systematic way. Okay, so also try to do that when you do it. Take the point. Okay, argument. This was an argument made. This is a rebuttal. This was an argument made. This was a rebuttal. And structure it into point one, point two, point three. You know, have a structure in your head. It is easier to communicate. Okay, so just keep these few things in mind for the next debate. All right, and nothing will be able to beat you. Nothing is better than solid preparation. If you know, if you have the information and facts at your disposal, it is very difficult to lose the debate. Some of the best debaters are people who have a very good grasp over the factual issues. Because at some point, you run out of anecdotes and experiences to share. But with information which is either through research, other people's research, secondary sources, people who have studied the subject, people who have spoken about it, if you know those things, your presentation is going to be much more effective. Okay, so please do spend a good bit of time preparing for the debate. One of the intentions of doing a debate is also that you read up on these things. Okay, so actually, if you just go back and look at some of the op-eds that were written after, I mean, even journal articles that were written after COVID struck on online education, there's a lot of very interesting, rich information about it and very interesting perspectives. For instance, one thing that I can immediately think about is the notion of education itself. So there were two terms in the motion which were very important: education and quality. Both of those terms, especially the against team, you could have easily opened up those terms for debate. Now, what is education? Is education about providing content, or is education about interaction? Is it about collective learning? Is it about people, and you don't only learn from your teachers, and you know that very well. You have experience offline education. You don't only learn from your teachers. Actually, you learn probably 20% from your teachers. Most of your learning is through seeing what other people are doing, talking to them, you know, interacting, fighting, arguing, you know, doing other things which are not necessarily related to education, like, you know, maybe discussing your general assembly, whatever you call it, student council issues. You know, all of those things are part of the experience of education. Those cannot be done online. You know, I mean, you must have also experienced this. Just deciding together what you think about something itself is so difficult. Even carrying out this debate was so difficult online, you know. So I think the case was much weaker for the for team than for the against team in this case. Just also try to understand. Also, when you debate, you can already have a sense of where people's general notions are about this. You know, so for instance, if you're arguing for online education, and you know that most people are against it. Okay, so you have a bigger challenge, right? So you need more preparation. But then you can provide some crucial insights which try to change people's views. But for the team who is arguing with public opinion, it's much easier. You simply have to drive home the point that things that people already know. Okay, so just try to strategize the debate, not just prepare for it in the sense, so you get information and you do your research, but you also think together with your team, how do you strategize doing the debate? Okay, so if you keep these things in mind, I think it will make for a much more interesting debate as well for people who are participating and for people who are listening. But this was good. What was what I am personally happy about is that a lot of people who generally don't talk spoke. Still, there were many who didn't, but hopefully in the next debate there will be more participation. And I think it's fine if you don't have the decorum related to class of raising hands and all that. You can just jump in and you can shout at each other and all of that is fine in the Q&A session, not in the opening statement bit. Because let's have some structured bits and then some informal kind of meandering parts as well through the debate. So that would be fine. Okay? I think that was broadly my comment about what happened today, but it was good fun. I think it was nice. Two things you have to do. One is that you have to do the Google form for the vote. And the second thing is that the two teams for the next debate have to start preparation. If you need reading material or references, please ask us. We'll provide them to you. But ask specifically, this is what you need, we'll give you. Don't generally ask, give us some reading for this. No. Okay. Ask specifically, okay, this is the kind of information we want, we'll provide it. Okay. All right. Anything anyone wants to say? Any comments, suggestions for how to improve the next debate? Or any general response to what happened today's discussion? Okay, if not, then maybe we can close. And next week we'll do a small writing exercise, which we'll do online, no preparation required. We'll come to class and we'll give it, we'll tell you what to do. And we will discuss it in class and that will be the end of it. Okay, but start preparing for the debate after 2 weeks. Okay? All right. Yeah, go ahead.
If possible, like, could we have like possibly a longer debate next time? Because you were like really engaged into today's debate. That was
okay. We can have a longer debate. Only thing, Napar, is that if it stretches too much, then it starts getting a little repetitive. Okay, so we have to.
Yeah.
You know, we'll do one thing. If substantively the debate is interesting and engaging and new things are coming up as we go on, then we'll continue. We'll give it more time. If it's getting repetitive, we'll put a stop to it. Okay? We'll do it like that. So we'll keep it.
Actually, this is unrelated to the subject entirely, but since Shweta is a Yo Master, we wanted to talk to her about a issue which needs some urgent attention. Is that okay with you, Shweta? If we can talk to you for 5 minutes, please.
Shweta. Yeah. I think Shweta is on the phone. So you want to continue this meeting and talk to her?
If it's okay with her.
Yeah, I think she's fine. She said yes. So you can continue this. I'll log out and then you can talk to her.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Anything else, guys? Lalit, you want to say something?
I was saying that can we stop the recording?
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.